We're live. Hi, we're with Caroline O'Rinton, and she's here to talk about her new book, The Lucky One. Thanks for joining us, Caroline.
Thank you for having me.
No problem. So first of all, can you tell us, how did you come up with the idea for The Lucky One?
Well, I could tell you the, shall I tell you the true story?
Yes.
I'll tell you the true story. I was living in California, and a girlfriend of mine there asked me if I would like to go on a wine tasting weekend, and the answer was, sure, okay, totally, absolutely.
Yeah.
Her name was Carrie, and with another friend of ours, Christina, we went up to Paso Robles, which is the wine district, and we had a fabulous time and visited many vineyards and tried a lot of the local produce with some cheese and some chocolate and did that kind of thing. And I remember being really inspired by the landscape, the beautiful rolling hills, the gorgeous vineyards, you know, how green it is when you come across where they're growing grapes, it'll be suddenly very green. And yet at the same time, there was like a lot of property that was still ranches from when they used to run cattle. So there was those kind of extremes there. And I just thought, oh, this would make a wonderful setting for a novel.
Perfect. And when you're writing your books, do you write every day? And how do you stay motivated?
Well, I guess it depends where you are in the process. So in the beginning, no, I don't write every day. I write as I feel things come upon me. I think, okay, I could put that down and put that down. Then as you move through the process and you start gathering together more chapters and more material, there is a period right towards the end when you are definitely writing every day, because you are so into the story that you can't possibly let the tail of it go. You know, you don't want to give it any breathing space. You want to just quickly say what it is you have to say. Then there's another fallow period where you don't really write anything at all, and your editor looks at it, other people look at it, and you think about it, and you worry about the knots that are in it, and is the plot working? And then when you get it back, that's usually a period of intense editing, line by line.
Okay. In another interview, I heard you mention that there's an Easter egg in The Lucky One that fans of the one who got away might pick up on. Can you explain what an Easter egg is?
Yes, I can. So an Easter egg, that's not my invention. I think it actually came from Microsoft or maybe even from Apple. But the idea is there is a tiny little secret in the book. And what I'm planning or hoping to do is to write four books. And they're not sequels of each other. They're not the same story. They're not the same characters, nothing like that. But each one will have a fluorescent cover. So we'll just call them, for argument's sake, the neon set. The first one, this one here, I don't know whether you can see that, but that's called The One Who Got Away, neon yellow, and this is neon orange, and there'll be a neon pink and a neon blue, or maybe a neon green, we'll see. And in each one, there will be one tiny little reference, just like a sentence that will refer to another book. So in this book, if you've read that one, you might, if you're a very close reader of this one, think, oh, hang on, she was in there, but she's not essential to the plot. And it doesn't matter if you miss it, but there are some people who, fabulous fans of mine, who read everything that I write, for whom I'm incredibly grateful, and I wanted to do something for them in a way of saying thank you. Like, I know you're reading the books, I appreciate it very much, and here's a little gift from me to you.
All right, thanks.
So far, this book has been out 10 days. And so far, only one person has got in contact with me on Facebook to say I found it.
Oh.
So it's pretty well hidden.
Yeah.
It's pretty well hidden. But one person did find it.
Okay. Good on them. And will The Lucky One have a sequel, or is it a standalone book?
It's not meant to have a sequel. It's meant to just leave you kind of gasping. Like, the idea is you're meant to just be, oh no! But a number of people said to me, you can't, you just can't, you know, they have to know what happens. And what's really interesting is a number of people have gotten in contact with me, usually on Facebook, that's where I tend to interact most with fans of the books. They do come through my website as well, but they come mostly through Facebook. And a number of them have said they need to know. And I feel like sometimes I feel like, well, you could decide as a reader, since I haven't decided myself yet as a writer, you could decide what has happened next. But I think they want to know from me. So we'll see.
Okay. And is there anything you can reveal about the next book?
Well, I think, yes. I mean, we can reveal anything because it's just you and me, right? So we can just reveal. We can say that I think, and anything we say here today in the privacy of this room is subject to change. Okay, it could change. But at the moment, I think it's going to be the bright pink one. I think it's going to be called the pretty one. So you'll have the one who got away, the lucky one, the pretty one, and then I think the fourth one is going to be called the one who won.
Okay.
I think. But I'm not 100% sure, but I think. So I think it'll be called the pretty one. It'll be pink. And as far as I can tell at the moment, there is a little girl at the center of it who's blonde with pink cheeks. Is she the pretty one though? I haven't decided. Like, she might be. She's in my mind a little bit. I'm thinking of her as the pretty one. Or possibly her mother, who is quite famous, could be the pretty one.
Okay.
That she could be the pretty, because she's one of two sisters. She's gone into quite a public profession and she's quite beautiful. She's aging a little, and so she's fiddling a bit with her face, but not too much. But her sister is not as beautiful and hasn't really gone into such a public profession. So I'm trying to decide, is it the mother who's the pretty one? Is it the daughter? Is it someone else entirely? That's about where we're at. It's very plastic still, very
yeah.
flexible.
Okay, great. Sounds very exciting. And you write fiction as well as non-fiction.
I do.
Do you prefer one to the other? And if so, why?
I like them both equally. And so I wrote a non-fiction book for HarperCollins, who published this book. It was called The Last Woman Hanged, or The Last Woman Hanged. And it was a true story about a woman who was executed for the crime of murdering her two husbands. And it's a lot more work, because you have to go into archives and you have to do research, you have to read old newspapers, you have to analyse the old documents, for example, the autopsy sheets and so on. And so it takes a lot longer. It's more rewarding in a way, because you feel like you've contributed something to the archives, you've contributed something to our understanding as Australians of the way justice was developed in the colonies, and in the way equal rights came about for women. So it's a very rewarding process, but it's a more time-consuming process. Right now, I'm having a lot of fun with the neon set. I'm enjoying it, and it's making me laugh and making me squirm, and I'm enjoying the feedback from people who are thrilled by the books. But that I wouldn't rule out doing it again. I might do it again.
Okay. All right. Keep an eye out then. And do you know what's going to happen at the end of your books when you start writing, or do
nope.
you make it up as
nope.
you go along?
Nope. I do not. And that's why it's interesting when you ask me that question about the pretty one, like, well, I don't really even know what it's about. I don't even really know how it's going to pan out or who the bad guys are. Like, in this book, I had really no idea how it was going to end until it ended. And then even I got a bit of a shock, because, you know, in the last 50 pages, a few dozen things happen which surprised even me. And I think it has to be that way. I think if you plot too much, or this is just me, I mean, other writers have their own process, I guess. For me, I feel like if I know how it's, I might give away too many clues along the way, and I really want it to be a surprise.
Okay. And did you have any idea that The One Who Got Away was going to be as successful as it was when you were writing it?
No! Did you? Like, I don't know. No, I didn't. I was thrilled that people loved it, and I was thrilled that they, that they passed it on to their friends and that they've recommended it to other people. But no, I didn't know. I just thought I loved it, obviously, but then you love them all when you're writing them, and you hope the best for all of them. You send them out into the world, and you hope people will read them. That's why we write, because you don't want to write just for yourself. I wanted to send it out into the world and have people read it, and they did, and it's wonderful.
Good. And inheritance is a huge part of The Lucky One. Have you had any personal experiences with inheritance or the problems that it can cause?
No, I have to tell you honestly, my family never owned a multi-million dollar estate. They never did. Like, the family in this book is a huge property. It's a huge property. And it has a castle on it. And it has another very modern home on it where they live. And an old cemetery where ancestors of that family have been buried. I mean, they've been holding that property for a long time. And then, I'm not giving anything away, in the first 10 minutes of the book, the developers have moved into the site because it's been sold, and as they're digging and doing all the things they're not meant to do, they start to bring up the corpses. And so then that's when people realise there's trouble on that estate. I have not had any problems like that, but I know that it's a very Australian story. I know that there's a lot of Australian families who have that issue, because we've had many established families in Australia who have been sitting on the same plots of land for a long period of time. And at some point, usually, it has to be sold. Just recently, the newspaper I work for, The Australian, did a series on families who are still sitting on the original land grant. Because, of course, all the land in New South Wales was granted to people as they arrived from, either as convicts and they became free, or when they arrived from England. And so we were able to ascertain that there's only about 44 families left that are sitting on the original land that their ancestors were given eight generations ago. In most cases, what happens is you have a father or a patriarch, and he marries, and they had seven children in that first generation, and then some of those went off and did their own thing, and usually the eldest son would stay, and he would then have a family, and he might have five children, because it gets less and less. Now we're down to two, we might get down to one. But in the beginning, when you were before contraception, and also there was a lot more religion in people's lives, people had a larger number of families. Eventually what happens is that you get four brothers and they all want a piece. And so what do? If you divide it up by four, each piece is too small to farm, so you really have to sell the whole thing. That has been an issue for Australian families, and I think that's why they get this book. I think even though this is set in California and it's a big winery, I think there are a lot of Australians who understand the issue of what it means to own either a big property or a holiday house. Like, I've had a number of people say, oh, my grandparents bought a holiday house out on the Mornington Peninsula in the 1950s for us to really enjoy as grandchildren. Now they're gone, and my parents are elderly, and we're wondering what should we do. And the instinct is almost always to sell, because if you've got eight grandchildren, you can't all use it at the same time. You all want it at the same time at Christmas, so easier to just sell it, maybe give the kids a foothold in the property market. It's a fascinating issue.
Yeah, it is. Okay, is there anything that you can reveal about the next book?
Oh, well, we've already done
Sorry, they came up twice.
That's all right.
Two people must have asked the same question. What do you think is behind the recent rise of the psychological thriller?
I have been racking my brain about it, because it has been such a phenomenon, hasn't it? The idea that these domestic thrillers, or these domestic noir thrillers, that have just taken off, and they're just all up to the front of the bestseller list. And I think it is to do with two things. The first is you have to recognise the characters. You have to think, okay, so in this book, you have a daughter-in-law who's a bit scheming and a bit untrustworthy. You have a young girl who's like 17. She's much more romantic about the property. She's not grasping for the money in the same way. You've got the patriarch who's a bit doddery. He's getting old. He's about to die, they feel, but when is he going to die? Eventually he has to, but it doesn't seem to be coming quickly enough for some people. All of these characters, I think, people recognise. But also, they're fun. These books, they're fun. It's not horror. You're not absolutely gasping the way you are with a book like American Psycho, where you're reading it, you know, you've got eyeballs being squashed and all that. You don't want that. You want a lot of fun, a mystery that people can solve, and a fast pace. And I think our attention span has become shorter, especially with Facebook and Twitter and the way we quickly move through. Even when you're watching Netflix, they're often 40 minutes now, aren't they? They're no longer an hour.
That's
or you
true.
Don't watch a movie over 2 hours anymore. Everything's been crunched. And so this, I think, a number of people told me they can read it in 24, tops 48 hours. And people like that. They want to get into it and get it over and done.
Okay. Your last two books have been set in the US, and you recently spent a year living there. Is it very different to Australia? And if so, how?
It's very different and it's very similar. Obviously, we speak the same language. And a lot of the things that you run into in California and in New York are exactly as you see them on TV. Because we've watched American programs, so CSI and all of those things, for so long, we understand. We recognize the police cars. We recognize the street signs. We recognize all of that. Culturally, I think we're very different from Americans. We're more self-deprecating. We are less, so if somebody says to me in the US, oh my God, you've got a book out, it'll be like, oh my God, you've got a book out, that is incredible, you're so amazing, hey, everybody, have you met my friend, she's just published her book, isn't this incredible, wow, that is just the best, whereas here it'll be like, you publish another book, have you? Writing a book, you know what I mean? We're just different. We're different. And it's, the goodwill is the same, but we express ourselves a bit differently. Here, we're more likely to kind of rib each other a bit about it. That sort of thing. Oh, you're out there promoting your book, are you? Typical. Like that kind of thing. So culturally, I think, and also our sense of humour is different. Like Australians are very dry, and in the US they are not dry. Like if you do sarcasm in the US, they can be a little bit offended.
And the town of Paso Robles, did I say that correctly?
Paso Robles, yes.
Paso Robles is in the middle of being gentrified. Do you think it's good or bad thing when a place gets trendy?
It's both. So it's a real place, obviously, and originally it was an old, like a traditional American town with a main street and a big high school and a few little shops, like just exactly as you'd imagine the main street in America to be. And now it's become very trendy, and it's got the wood-fired pizza, and it's got organic this and that. And a lot of the wineries that are opening around the town are organic wines. People are very concerned about things like soil conservation. There used to be, there are a lot of prohibitions on bringing down the oak trees because Paso is famous for its towering oaks, which are really beautiful. And there's a restriction on you can't just remove them anymore, whereas in the past you just would clear land for your cattle. I think it's good to maintain your traditions. I think that things like the Pioneer Day that they have there, where people bring their cattle down from the ranches and march them through the main street, and the cowboys are there and they have their long-eared steers. I think it's important to acknowledge your cultural history. And at the same time, I can see that when you're living in those little villages, of course you would like your nice coffee and you would like your organic olive oil and things like that. So it's a balance. You don't want to push the old people out, but you want to welcome the new.
Okay. And I think that's it for our questions now.
Well, thank you. Did they come through Facebook, those questions?
Yeah.
That is so cool.
Yeah, that
is so cool.
Thank you so much, Caroline.
Thank you.
Caroline's new book, The Lucky One, is out now. So go grab yourself a copy.
Thank you, Lara.